2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 16 through 17, as Rick read for us. Standing firm in our faith. Everyone has a father. Some good, some bad, some indifferent, some just there. Some of us never had a father at home. Sadly, 19.5 million children, more than 1 in 4 today in America, live without a father in the home. This has affected our entire society that we live in today. 47% of children without a father live in poverty. Girls without fathers are 7 times more likely to be pregnant as a teen. Girls without fathers face twice greater risk of infant mortality. Girls are twice as likely to be obese. Girls are twice as likely to drop out of high school without a father. Most children without a father will develop behavioral problems. Boys are 20 times more likely to go to prison. 20 times. They are 4 more times likely to use drugs and alcohol. They are much more likely to face abuse and neglect. They are much more likely to suffer from depression. Children with absent fathers are much more likely to become absent fathers themselves. Boys with absent fathers are more likely to be an absent father themselves. Girls without fathers are much more likely to have children with absent fathers. It's a cycle. It just continues. Infant death, as I said, is actually 4 times higher for absent children with absent fathers. Children with both parents means a much better student, a much more likelihood of getting A's and college scholarships. The facts are, fathers who are involved with their children vastly improve their children's overall emotional and social well-being. Vastly improve. They are much less likely to be mistreated. They do better in school. 270% much less likely to deal drugs and do drugs. Involved fathers greatly reduce mom's stress. Involved fathers. Boys have much fewer behavior problems. Girls have fewer psychological problems when they have involved dads. The worst state in America for absent fatherism is Mississippi, 36.2%. Louisiana, 34.4%. Bottom line, father's absence is to blame for many of our most of our social ills affecting children today. They have lost their firm foundation without a father in the home. Our Father God is always completely involved in the lives of those who trust in Him, because He will what? Never leave us nor forsake us.
Amen.
Children without a father in the home always worry about being abandoned. Something they never get over. Our God has revealed Himself in the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, through whom we have a firm foundation, able to stand the test of our faith and our future. The Bible says that God is the Father of the fatherless. If you don't have a father on this earth, you have a father in heaven. And those of you whose father has left this earth, your father has gone on to heaven, would you stand in honor of your father today? If your father has gone to heaven, stand in honor of your father. Amen. Amen. Quite a few of you. Thank you. And you are what you are because of your father's devotion to you. And many of you are in church today because of the way your father raised you. And that's a testament to him. First of all, we can stand firm in our faith because our Father loves us. 2 Thessalonians 2:16. Now our Lord Jesus Christ Himself and God, even our Father, which hath loved us. May our Lord Jesus Christ Himself and God our Father, who loved us, He loved us. The Lord Jesus Christ, God our Father, loves us. Let's forever settle that. The cross has forever settled the fact that God loves us. No one can say they're not loved. John 17:24. Father, I will that they also, whom Thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which Thou hast given me, for Thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. For God so loved the world, John 3:16. 2 Thessalonians 2:16 says, Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father, which hath loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. No one in hell today can say that God did not love them. No human alive today can say that God does not love them. He loves because that's what he does. God is love. 1 John 4:8. He loves for that's what he is. That's what God is love. As we live and breathe on this earth, so God loves. Love is of God, for God is love. Love was not invented. Love is. It came from God. We don't love because some kind of synapses functioning in our brain, or the urge to merge, I guess. We love because God put it in our hearts, because he is love. 1 John 4:7, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. Everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Love is of God, for that's what God is. And we are the objects of his love. Oh, how blessed we are to be objects of the love of God. How blessed the child is to be object of the love of the Father. Some fathers just don't show love or any affection at all. Back when I grew up, affection wasn't shown much, but I knew my father loved me. That's one thing I never doubted. But you should show your affection. Tell your children you love them. Tell the people important in your life that you love them. And mean it. The love of God. How grateful we should be for love. And that God loves us. Love is not mentioned in the book of the Quran, the Muslim guide to their faith, the Muslim unholy book. Love, that God doesn't love them. He just wants to make them, force them. Power, subjection. Islam means surrender or subjection. God doesn't want us to surrender. He wants us to love him and give our lives to him. He wants us to surrender our lives to him, yes. But he doesn't ask you to forcibly follow him. He invites you. Jesus said, come with arms open. He didn't say it with a sword. You better come or else. He said, come with that soft, gentle voice. The sweet sound of the Spirit. Soft and gentle. Persuasion. All this because of the love of God. We're here today because of the love of God, our Father. Our Heavenly Father loved us. That's why we're here today. That's why we have a Savior to celebrate. A Savior to follow. A Savior to accept. And a heaven to be gained. Yes, I don't want to go to hell. I don't have to because of Jesus Christ and the love of God. Romans 8:38, For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is love, that Christ sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross for our sins. That's how we know God loved us, because of Jesus Christ. Paul was persuaded that God loves us so much that nothing could ever separate us from his love for us. The people in hell are there because God loves them, but they rejected that love. God loves people in hell. He didn't want them to go there. It wasn't created for them. It was created for the devil and his angels who rebelled. He doesn't want anybody to go there. He wants us to accept the love he has for him, for us, and trust him as our Savior. If he loves us, we can trust him. Can you trust people that love you? Sometimes here on this earth. Sometimes you can only trust them so far. But you can always trust God because he loves us. God didn't have to send us a Savior. His love is forever presented in Jesus Christ. Listen, when you're sharing Christ with somebody, when you're talking to somebody about Jesus, talk about Jesus. Tell them about Jesus. Point them to Jesus. He's the Word of God. Use Jesus. Tell them he loves you. Cares about you. It's all because of Jesus that we can be saved and go to heaven. 2 Thessalonians 2:16. Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself, God, even our Father, which hath loved us. I love reading that. God our Father loves us. Jesus the Son loves us. How can we not come to Him and trust Him? Where did our love for God dissolve into love for ourselves above God? We actually dislike being loved by God because that means we're accountable to Him. I'm telling you, people don't want to be loved by God. It's hard to believe because of Romans 14:12. Every one of us shall give account of himself to God. I don't want to give account to God. I don't need your love, God. I want to be accountable to me. I'm number one. You love yourself more than God. People are in hell because they love themselves more than Jesus. That's basically it. Who do you love? There's a song. Who do you love? Yourself or Jesus Christ? Every one of us shall give account of himself to God. How many is everyone? How many? That's every one of us. How certain is shall? Every one of us shall give account of himself to God. How is certain in the Bible is shall? Shall is certain. You will do it. And I give you a hint. You ain't gonna like giving account of yourself to God. So we rather let Jesus handle it. I put my sins on Jesus Christ. He has already given account. He's already suffered the payment for my sin. We can stand firm in our faith because our Father loves us. Secondly, we can stand firm in our faith because our Father gives us assurance of salvation. 2 Thessalonians 2:16. He has given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. And His grace gave us unfailing courage and firm hope and given us everlasting comfort and encouragement and the good, well-established, and absolutely certain hope and steadfast assurance of salvation by His grace. Steadfast assurance. We can stand firm in our faith because our Father gives us assurance of salvation. John 10:28. I give unto them eternal life and they shall never perish. Never, never, no, not ever perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. You know, I hope your Heavenly Father gave you good things from time to time. Little presents, little gifts, made things for you, tried to help you out, and show you how to do things the right way, the easier way, but not always easier way. I always look for the easier way, Dad. My dad was a good guy for shortcuts. The trouble is, things always tore up quicker. So he finally had to learn the hard way like me that you better fix them right the first time. Our Father gives us good things. Our Father in heaven gives us good things. Does God ever give you something that's not good? Well, sometimes He punishes us and takes us to the woodshed. But that's a good thing in the end. Hey, if you don't paddle the child, you're going to spoil the child, right? We have to get some discipline every now and then to learn the error of our ways. God is truth. His word is truth. John 17:17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. He gives us assurance of salvation because He gives us His undenied, truthful, absolutely without error word of God. The Bible is the word of God, right? And through the Bible, we get assurance of salvation. It's His word, so we can trust it, right? 2 Thessalonians 2:16, good hope through grace. It says, giving us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. What is grace? Grace is getting something you absolutely do not deserve and could never earn. That's grace. Think about that. Getting something you do not deserve nor could ever earn on your best day. That's like me being able to dunk a basketball. Yeah, on a 4-foot Nerf goal. But on an NBA basketball or regulation goal, I need grace. I need a boost. I mean, I need totally somebody to do it for me. And that's what Jesus did. He did it for us. Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I can't even get a boost to dunk the ball. Somebody's got to do it for me. And that's what Jesus did. By grace are you saved through faith. Our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, given to us by our loving, good Father. God decided to save us by grace, not through works, because There's none righteous, no, not one. God saw that we couldn't keep the works of the law. He gave us the law as our schoolmaster to show us we cannot measure up. Here's the requirements, gang, kids. Here's the requirements, the Ten Commandments. No wonder Moses broke the first ones. Impossible. But God said, nah, you're not getting away that easy. We're going to do them again. These are the requirements that cannot be broken. We have to be able to meet God's standards. Holiness! Well, we can't do that, so we have to have grace. Somebody has to stand in for us. Somebody that's never sinned, that's Jesus Christ. By grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. What part of a gift is works? If you give me something, what part of that gift is works? Not of works, lest any man should boast. I say this all the time, but Santa Claus doesn't give you anything because you deserve it. Newsflash. You don't deserve anything for Christmas. We're all bad. I ain't been nothing but bad. Have you heard that song? I ain't getting nothing for Christmas. By the way, Christmas is only 6 months away. Get your gifts ready for me. I'm running a little short. Jude chapter 1 verse 4. There are certain men crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. Ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Some people don't want grace. They don't want God to love them, and they don't want the grace of God. Certain people have crept in unnoticed, just as if they were sneaking in by a side door. Ungodly persons whose condemnation was predicted long ago, for they distorted the grace of God into decadence and immoral freedom, viewing it as an opportunity to do whatever they want and denying to disown our only master, the Lord Jesus Christ. They don't care about grace. They only want to use it as a license to sin and do what they want. People have come into the church with a license to sin and do whatever they want. 1 John 1:8-10 has the answer for that. People who say, well, grace just gives you a license to sin. You're going to go to heaven anyway. You might as well enjoy it. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we, verse 10 says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar and His word is not in us. We sin as Christians. We do. Not because we want to, but because that's what we are. We don't have our sinless, perfected body yet. Sin has not been destroyed. It has been defeated and conquered. But we still have to deal with sin in our own lives as Christians. So what does God do with it? We're forgiven sins past, present, future as far as our standing with God. As far as our legal standing with God, we are forgiven for our sins as though we're already in heaven made righteous. But we sin daily as we go through this life. We fall short. And Paul and the Apostle John, in their writings, always made sure that we understand that we have not reached sinful perfection in this life. It's impossible. We will one day we'll shed this body of sin, this flesh, one day, and never be under its captivity again. But until then, we ask Christ to forgive us and restore our relationship. It's like a father to a son or to a daughter, like a father to a child. Before God is your Savior, He's your Creator. He created you, but you're not His. You're not His child. There's no such thing as the fatherhood of God unless you're a believer in Jesus Christ. That's right. He's your father then. Until then, He's your Creator. You are estranged from Him. He does not know you as His child. He wants to invite you to come and renew the relationship and be born again. That's why being born again is such an incredible change. We go from created creature, sinful and undone and unclean, to a child of God.
Amen.
And when we mess up, He wants to restore the relationship we have. See, He doesn't want to kick us out. He's a good coach. You know, a good coach in football or basketball, if you mess up, he doesn't say, you're off the team forever. You're out of here. All I did was double dribble. Well, you shouldn't have. You're out. What kind of hard-hearted coach is that? Well, It's not a good coach. He doesn't love them. He's not. They're not part of the team, evidently, if you just kicked out that easy. But a good coach would say, hey, come on, you messed up? Here's where you messed up. And back in my day, you'd get a dress shoe, size number 10, up your backside. The pointy style. Boy, if they did that stuff today, I've had basketballs thrown at me, my teeth rattled, shook, kicked at, cussed at, and I loved my coaches, every one of them. I knew they loved me. Jack, you're weird. Because they wanted the best out of me. Sometimes it took a little pushing for me and a little kicking and shoving. Listen, God loves us, cares about us, wants us to be His, wants us to give us assurance. We have assurance in Christ. We stand firm in our faith because our Father gives us assurance of our salvation. He saved us by grace through faith. Finally, we can stand firm in our faith because our Father gives us the power to stand. 2 Thessalonians 2:17 comforts your hearts and establishes you. Stand firm. Establish means stand firm in every good word and work. Encourage you and strengthen you to always do and say what is godly. Comfort and encourage and strengthen your hearts. Keep them steadfast and firm on course. Keeping them godly means to keep them on course. Stay on course. Without courage, armies will fail. We need courage. Comfort your heart, establish you, stand firm in every good word and work. We need the courage to stand firm, this day especially. Without gas to power our cars, they'll be useless. We have to have power within us to enable us to stand firm and strong in our faith. 1 Corinthians 4:20, for the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. The kingdom of God is not great talking points, flawless arguments, hot debate, flowery speeches, or motivational talks that gives us power, but the living word of God. Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is quick, alive, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Our Father gives, in His wisdom, gave us the word of God that is powerful and gives us the power to stand, able to penetrate the hardened hearts of men toward God. That's why I tell you, use the Bible when you witness to somebody. Say the name of Jesus. Jesus is the living Word of God. The devil hates that. It'll bring conviction of sin upon people. The Word of God divides because some people don't like it and hate being accountable to God, as we said. The Word of God divides people. Use the Bible. Don't be ashamed to use the Bible. Oh, the Bible is so old-fashioned. No, it's not. It is the living Word of God, full of prophecies that have been fulfilled and will be fulfilled. The Bible is not a book. It is God's, not just a book. It is God's book. It is His Word, eternal. I was reading the Bible yesterday and ran across a passage that I've read 1,000 times. And it spoke to me. I realized all of a sudden the greatness of God, just the awesomeness and greatness of God came upon me. And then last night, Anita and I went to a show at the Mac, and we heard a lady sing, what was the name of that song? Oh, How Great Thou Art. And that same feeling hit me. We don't realize what we have. The greatness of God. We think this giant they've made, how great and awesome. The greatness of God, that's a nothing. Nothing on this earth compares to the greatness of God, our Father. Amen. We don't have any clue how great He is. How great Thou art. Amen. How great Thou art. When we see Him, nothing in this world will compare. Mount Everest, no wonder the world will compare to the greatness of God. And we're going to think, what were we thinking to follow the devil and his little pleasures? Oh, let's go have some fun on Father's Day. Let's go have some fun and get drunk. And let's have some good time. Oh, this is what living's all about. That's what beer commercials tell you. That's really living. No, we have no idea till we become the greatness, the presence of the greatness of God, the glory of God, and know that He loves us. He's on our side. Would you want to face the greatness of God and be His enemy? Oh my goodness. No wonder they want to run, call the rocks to fall on them and hide from the wrath of the Lamb. Listen. The greatness of God, our Father, we cannot comprehend it. We better give our whole heart, soul, life, and everything we have to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, because He is great. None others compare to Him. People are so selfish, though. They only care about themselves so much that they can't see the truth. Matthew 23:37. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but within are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. Sadly, some people have had fathers that abused them mentally and sexually due to appearing outwardly good, but inward are full of death and sin and hell, and all they can do to others. Some people in this world just don't want God. We have to just understand that. They're wicked. They just are dead, full of trespasses and sins. But God in His greatness, one day will have His day with them. We don't want that for them. Pray for them. We want to love our enemies. We want to pray for them that use us. The persecution we're going to endure in the days ahead. Pray for those that persecute you. Love them. Maybe they can be won to Christ. But if we think they're going to win one thing over us, and our great and awesome God is standing by to come and get us through Jesus Christ, or come and get you through death, why do we fear anything? I love Kelly's faith. I love Kelly, but I love his faith.
Amen.
He is not afraid of what he's going to face because of Christ and the awesomeness of God.
Right.
I tell you, we don't really see the awesomeness of our Father until we really get to know, to need Him and know Him, right?
That's right.
Then we realize we have it made. Mm-hmm. We do. We have it made in Jesus Christ. We can stand firm in our faith because our Father. We have a Father that loves us. We can leave here today full of hope and encouragement and strength. We can stand firm in our faith because our Father gives us assurance of this great salvation. We can stand firm in our faith because our Father gives us the power to stand. Romans 10:17, faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. The powerful Word of God.
Amen.
People need Jesus Christ, and they need Him today. Yeah, we need fathers, earthly fathers, but we need Jesus Christ. People need the Lord. That song we used to sing. Oh, how we need the Lord, because He is the only one that can do anything for us. The only one that can save us. The only one that will save us. And one day, He's going to make everything the way it ought to be. And give us joy everlasting, full of grace and mercy and truth. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer.